I've always considered myself a person who doesn't have that many fears, especially when it comes to how I navigate relationships. I believe that confidence is one of the most important parts of finding the right people in your life, growing with the ones who are meaningful to you, and being satisfied with who you are. And that's why, especially in the last 2 years, one of the only things that has petrified me is the concept of manipulation. I've seen so many people do things recently, and often people I'm close with, that hurt and control my friends, and it completely ruins my relationship with them. And I've been manipulated too. And it's the worst. I wouldn't wish that upon anybody. Which is exactly why this mixtape is horrifying. Coming off of the major success that was House of Balloons in 2011, I wouldn't be surprised if nobody thought Abel Tesfaye would be able to replicate the sound and tone of that project, considering its haunted strip club atmosphere that just felt so exquisite. But man, did he defy expectations. Just 5 months later, Abel comes back with Thursday, which brandishes even more airy instrumentals and spectral synthesizers, and this new character portrayal, which, having found new confidence and popularity, has become even more upfront and clear about his malicious intentions. This project, while being aesthetically similar to House of Balloons in almost every metric of interest, has a completely different energy to it. Where his debut project was colorless and stark, Thursday is numb. And this highlights a key difference between Thursday and House of Balloons right off the bat. This project will focus not on just the Weeknd, but his partners, his puppets, his victims. We're thrown right back into the Weeknd's world in the middle of a situation between himself and the character that we will be referring to as Valerie. She's smitten, completely fallen for him, and she's willing to do anything. In the Thursday narrative, the Weeknd is no longer the hero, he's the antagonist. And Valerie is the lens through which we are viewing this character, which begins in Lonely Star. This instrumental is defined by its thundering electric guitar licks and its punchy 808 percussions, but rounded out really well by the constant distorted vocal sample of Abel moaning in the background. It's barely audible, but it brings so much life to the world and aesthetic that Abel created in House of Balloons and is looking to build on here. It brings us back into this world of danger and woe, as if the sample is the souls of the damned warning you not to go any further. On the verses, the Weeknd coaxes Valerie into running to him, to being his best friend, as he points out that he can meet her needs in areas she has been struggling with. You can see him turning the screws right off the bat when he opens up by saying, "It seems like pain and regret are your best friends." And he takes that weakness, that vulnerability, and he uses it to get what he wants. This is... it's sick. Here's where we are. She knows the Weeknd, she knows about his lifestyle, but more importantly, she knows that she can never make him love her enough to truly get what she wants. But she also knows that she can't live without him because of the seduction that Abel sings about all throughout House of Balloons and on this song. He keeps offering her what she thinks she wants. So what she does is, she settles. She can only have him one out of the 7 days of the week. Their relationship is transactional, conditional, where he gets everything that he wants, but 6 out of those 7 days, she's the lonely star. She seeks his approval, his validation so much that she gives up on having real love, a real relationship with him. She just wants to be remembered, to be a person who made an impact. She's realized that she isn't actually good enough for what he says his standards are, and so they only meet on Thursdays so that he won't get sick of her. She waits for him. She's beautiful for him. She gives her whole body. There's intimacy, but no attachment. He's using her. This love, this having it all fantasy that he promised her isn't real. It's just a facade so he can have his one night of pleasure and move on to someone else the next night. But that's not even the worst thing about it. She lives for the weekend who doesn't actually love her. She waits for companionship one night of the week, hoping that it will get better, but it's not. She's miserable. She hates herself. She has no life. And she knows it. And Valerie's been manipulated so badly that she doesn't even care.
And the thing about it is, I could see girls just being like, oh my God, I love The Weeknd. I can't wait to meet him. But he's writing songs like, you ain't shit. Yes. But if you still want to kick it.
Exactly. That's that pimp shit.
Yes.
Pimp shit.
I'm that nigga with the hair talking about fucking bitches, popping pills, living life so trill. And if an average chick can be like, I still want to hang out with you. Yep. You got a special talent. You got a special talent.
In order for us to have a proper understanding of what's going on in the Thursday narrative, we need to quickly recap House of Balloons and everything we learned about the character of The Weeknd in that mixtape. On the surface, The Weeknd is your prototypical nightlife obsessive. He's hooked on any drug imaginable, finding a different sexual partner every night, and he's loving every second of it. But a deeper look at this project provides a much more telling look at what he's actually trying to tell us with this character. On songs like House of Balloons or Wicked Games or The After Party, there's these really important moments of transparency and authentic feelings that reveal The Weeknd is actually miserable doing what he's doing, and that sadness creates a cycle that we see in House of Balloons. And he doesn't really offer a resolution. To see how these relationships work more in depth, I would encourage you to watch my House of Balloons video, but I'll wrap it up quickly here. It starts with The Weeknd's fear of being lonely and being irrelevant to those around him. This fear creates a need to manipulate others and extract pleasure from anyone who will get close to him. It's a paradox. It's an endless cycle of frustration and failure. And it's all caused by fear. This failure to find a resolution to the problem by pushing away any sense of meaningful living is the glaring flaw in The Weeknd's character. He lives in ignorance and he doesn't mind it. But what's interesting about House of Balloons is that the perspective is narrowed to only being a character study of The Weeknd. We know that his life is toxic and it's dangerous and it makes him more and more miserable as time goes on. But we're only left to assume the negative impacts that his actions have on his victims, a negative impact that Thursday is going to present to us. We know The Weeknd is depressed and living in misery, but he's too afraid to break out of his ways. So he's going to keep abusing substances and keep victimizing women. And as far as we're aware, he's loving every second of it. Valerie's story continues in Life of the Party, where Abel acts as the narrator detailing a typical Thursday night of hers and what it's like. After being seduced by The Weeknd and brought into his world, his lifestyle, she's become just like him, a drug-addicted star who can't seem to stay out of trouble. The gritty electric guitar sample is sinister, the punchy 808s are sharp. This song sounds like the cascading soundtrack to complement these scenes, this montage where Valerie just keeps getting into all types of trouble. And this is where we see the new manipulative tactic of controlling enter the mix. Listening to this track makes The Weeknd seem like the Emperor in Star Wars as he stands in the back watching people fight each other, watching the destruction that he started. This is the consequence of the events in Lonely Star. Desperate to seek The Weeknd's validation, Valerie has found herself doing things that she would never dreamed of. And unfortunately, it doesn't give her what she's looking for. It just makes the cycle worse and more desperate and more hopeless. After learning of the cycle that drives the relationship between Valerie and The Weeknd, this track is a check-in with his mind state. What he tells himself as the propagator of this self-destructive lifestyle that she's now a part of. And if it hasn't been made clear already, this is a completely one-sided relationship. Despite Valerie wanting more, The Weeknd urges her to wait until Thursday, to only call on Thursday, because that's her designated time. What this does is it keeps him on track. It keeps him on this linear path that only leads to shallowness, but also pleasure. by making sure that their relations are rigid and on a schedule. There's no strings attached. This is exactly what the Weeknd wants. It's comfortable, it's easy, it takes him exactly where he wants to be. The zone. Besides The Morning, this track is probably the poppiest song in all of The Weeknd's early work. I've always been obsessed with the stark euphoria that listening to this creates. And I love that aesthetic so much because it's indicative of something deeper. It illustrates just how empty the relations that Valerie and The Weeknd have. There's an authoritative tone that he sings with on this track. I feel like it shows his compulsive need to control the situation. It's like he's saying, "Stop talking and let me do this. I know what I'm doing." But the end of the first verse into the chorus is what really just makes me begin to shudder in pure shock as he tells her that he's making love to someone else through you. And so he closes his eyes so that he doesn't feel anything other than pleasure. Then, on the chorus, he's singing about how he can't even see. He's losing any humanity he has left, but he's still going to be all over her, to touch her, to extract any pleasure he can still get, because that's all he cares about. And since he's in the zone, he doesn't have to worry about anything else. No strings attached, all pleasure included. That is what The Weeknd wants. When he says that he's making love to her through you, he's telling Valerie that she's not the only one, and she's not even the best one, since he has to imagine that he's with someone else to get the pleasure that he seeks. And in doing that, he makes her feel even more worthless and more obsessed. He's turned the screws. He's gotten exactly what he wants. He's in the zone. The Weeknd's world teaches us a lot, but not explicitly. Not in a manner that is direct. It's more of a living parable, a cautionary tale that we're expected to dissect ourselves. This atmosphere, the sound, it doesn't sound like anything else in the entire realm of music. It's a perfect, striking blend of darkness and danger. While the lyrics might seem like it, this music isn't just describing sex at parties. It forges this feeling of uneasiness inside the listener. It's as if when you listen, you enter the world of The Weeknd as this shadowy void of demons and voices keep pulling you in. And when you're finally there, you're nothing but this personification of your inner lusts and desires, finding something to fulfill them. That aesthetic is meant to personify the character of The Weeknd, and it simultaneously shows us what we're supposed to learn from him. By listening to his music and learning from what happens between him and Valerie, we're connecting with this deeper desire to avoid falling into fear and the temptations that come with it, which is exactly what leaves us vulnerable to being manipulated. And the most important screw that the devil can turn to manipulate you is the need for attachments. The way that relationships cover your deepest desires and insecurities. By threatening to take those away, we learn what really drives us to do what we do. And in this narrative, Thursday might just be Valerie, just one girl, but it's also supposed to be the day, the one, that's closest to The Weeknd, which is, of course, another false promise that he uses to control her. After being in the zone and getting what he wants from Valerie, The Birds Part 1 sees The Weeknd leveling with her about how transactional their relationship truly is. This is my favorite song on this project. The marching percussions and the flying siren-like synthesizers make this track sound like this overdone anthemic apology. He's so arrogantly blunt and upfront about his feelings here, as he tells her that she means nothing more to him than the pleasure that he gets from their relationship, and she shouldn't think anything more of it either. I think this first verse is really telling, as part of his warning to not fall in love comes out of selfishness so he won't have to hurt someone else, but I actually think that it's deeper. From what we know of The Weeknd, it sounds like on this verse he's alluding to the fact that he used to want real love, or even does now, but he's scared of it. He's scared of loving somebody and not being loved back, because that would make him vulnerable for maybe the first time. And he can speak from experience that nobody's gonna catch you when you fall, because they don't care. And this in and of itself is a concise explanation for why The Weeknd is the way he is. It's easier in his mind to not care about anybody else and stray away from attachments, because people don't actually care about you even when they say they do. And in the heart of the Weeknd, that's a lot harder to deal with than it is to not try and form any meaningful relationships at all. So he tells her not to fall in love because he's just a bird. Like a bird would do in the summer, he might stay for a while and enjoy the company, the warmth, but eventually winter comes and he'll fly off looking for something better. Valerie takes in this warning from the Weeknd and she doesn't listen. He inevitably cheats on her and disaster strikes. Valerie didn't listen and she can't deal with the grief. She can't live without him. And now she's gone. She killed herself. This is clearly not new to him. She's just another victim. And on top of that, the Weeknd can't say that he didn't warn her. She knew what would happen, but still couldn't handle the misery. This is what manipulation does. He refers to himself as a bird throughout part 1 and part 2 of the song, which is often used to symbolize the embodiment of freedom. But the outro of the track changes this line of thinking a bit. The Weeknd's not just a bird, he's a crow. A scavenger, a conniving black predator of carcasses. They feed off the emotional and physical weaknesses of others. They wait, they seek out the proper opportunity, and they attack. And they don't stop until you're gone. Gone has a slightly different appeal from almost every song on this project. It holds this 8-bit synth loop and slurred vocals from Abel, and then this oscillating vocal mix creates a claustrophobic slog. I feel like this song is supposed to embody the feelings and atmosphere of Abel's nightlife, a drug-induced slur of sex and substance abuse. This is the most detail we've seen from him so far in terms of a play-by-play of his nightlife. And it's about what you'd expect. It doesn't teach us much about the Weeknd that we don't already know, but it's what he doesn't say that makes this song pretty shocking and telling too. We just came off the death of one of the Weeknd's partners, his closest one. She killed herself out of shame and grief of what the Weeknd did to her. And after singing about how he's just a bird, he's just moved on, just like that? Gone details the next night with a different woman, doing the same activities, the same things, just a new person. He doesn't care about Valerie, he doesn't grieve her, and he's still doing the same exact thing. He wasn't lying about this lack of attachment, he really just doesn't care. Rolling Stone is another completely different but welcome change of pace. It's an acoustic guitar ballad where Abel monologues about how he's moving forward despite his awareness of his flaws and his habits and his failure to improve. It's an eerie track, and not because of the lyrics or even the sound, but because it shows us the Weeknd isn't unaware of who he is. He's completely aware of his behavior and the repercussions he's caused throughout this record, and he doesn't have any remorse. There's a shocking revelation that Rolling Stone creates that's a tough pill to swallow as someone who considers themselves a fan of The Weeknd and his music, and that's that the character Valerie isn't just a face value narrative. She's metaphorical. An illustration of not only all of the Weeknd's victims, but of us. While not everything on the record applies to Abel's widespread fanbase, every time he specifically addresses Valerie on this record, it can be perceived as a double entendre for us. Think of Life of the Party, which sees Abel narrating Valerie's new lifestyle after being brought into his world, the way she's copied his way of life. Maybe he's talking about her, but in an alternate reality, he's talking about a fan who was influenced by what he wrote about in his music. This can be applied every time he uses the word you on this project, but it all comes to a head in Rolling Stone. I think I'll be different. he knew that this wasn't forever. The Trilogy era, he knew things would change and that people would hate him for it. In universe, this song does apply because Valerie and all of his victims will eventually become privy to the fact that they're not his only choice, and he fears that they won't be his lonely star anymore. But even more so than all of his other music, I feel like this is an open letter to the fans. The 2011 version of The Weeknd was dark and scary and toxic, but what brought that all together was the mystery. The more popular you get, the less that that mystery impacts you and your artistry. And now in 2022, The Weeknd is one of the most popular names in the entire world. And sitting on that knowledge, knowing that you would get to that point, it has to induce a just godlike level of confidence that most of us can't even fathom. Getting everything you want now and then having a promise of even more in the future. If that was me, I would feel like, I'd feel like a god. The final song of this tape starts off with what sounds like a descent from space, the soaring aftermath from a climactic journey, as these raunchy electric guitar riffs enter the mix with a steady skipping set of drums and a twinkling piano progression that introduces Abel's vocals. He opens up by citing a lack of a father figure as the reason why he is who he is, and he thanks his father for the lifestyle that he's able to lead due to his absence. It's another instance where you feel like you see Abel's self-awareness begin to creep in, but then he covers it up with his ego and pleasure-oriented mindset again. He then proceeds to serenade us with a stream of consciousness that lacks any semblance of remorse, this self-propagated ego trip that ends in the conclusion that The Weeknd is a god. And so, he spent this entire record ruining someone else's life, causing her to eventually kill herself in her own obsession. And after all this manipulation and shallow behavior, this is what he tells us? There's nothing. No remorse, no humility, no understanding of how horrible he is. The Weeknd is untamed, and he's going to do all of this again. I mean, why wouldn't you if you think you're a god? He has no accountability, no threat to his behavior, and no possibility of losing all of his benefits. He has everything made. This is horrible, guys. I can't take it. The Weeknd's awful. I'm done. After 9 songs of seeing the consequences of The Weeknd's actions, we're left in an uncomfortable spot. We've seen how dangerous this is, the terrible repercussions of what The Weeknd is doing, and there's no light at the end of the tunnel. There's a great Kanye tweet that's always stuck with me that says everything you do stems out of either fear or love, and I think that applies here. The narrative of this record, whether it's obvious or not, is only possible because of both The Weeknd and Valerie's fear. The Weeknd is scared of being a nobody, scared of being lonely, but he's also scared of being hurt by what he does to others, so he makes sure that he's always the one holding the knife. Valerie, on the other hand, is scared of loneliness, but she's mostly scared of being unloved, not being deemed worthy of someone else's affection and intimacy. And this fear goes so far that she settles for giving only physical pleasure to someone else one day out of the week, so she at least has that one day to look forward to, even if she's miserable the other 6. And so let me tell you right now that if you're using someone in your life as an emotional crutch, a band-aid to cover up an insecurity, then that relationship isn't worth your time. The people in your life should make you better, help you grow, they should thrive harmoniously with you. And if they're only in your life so you can get their validation or their love or to say you're close to them, then the only person you're hurting is yourself. Attachment in and of itself isn't wrong, but attachment for any reason other than your unconditional love for that person, well, oftentimes it leads to manipulation and misery. We learn this and see it put into practice from the narrative between The Weeknd and his tango with Valerie. I hope that makes sense to you guys, and I hope it helped with some reflection maybe on how your life is going. It definitely does for mine as well. And as for The Weeknd, well, at the end of this story, he still thinks he's a god. But hopefully, with 9 more songs, they can bring him back down to earth a little bit. Right?